before Brother Abner brings the message, I'll have the special.
And love the words of that song. Thank you, Brother Wayne, for sharing with us that beautiful special today. I want you to turn to Luke 23, and for a scripture reading, we're going to start at verse 27 and read together through verse 38. Luke 23, starting at verse 27. If you want to stand for the reading of the word, you're welcome to. And there followed him a great company of people and of women, which also bewailed and lamented him. But Jesus, turning unto them, said, Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming in the which they shall say, Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bear, and the paps which never gave suck. Then shall they begin to say to the mountains, Fall on us, and to the hills, Cover us. For if they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified Jesus and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted Jesus' raiment and cast lots, and the people stood beholding. And the rulers also with them derided Jesus, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. This is the King of the Jews. Little did they know how true that inscription was. You may be seated. In verse 34, the scripture says clearly, Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When I read that, it's hard for me to comprehend, as Brother Wayne sang this morning, the grace, the love, and the forgiveness of God. Jesus had come to his own, and his own received him not. They cried, Crucify him. They cried for Barabbas, one of the most notable thieves and murderers in their society, to be let go and Jesus to be crucified. And here he is on the cross in pain and agony, and all of these insults being hurled at him. And Jesus responded by saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Forgive them. And we don't have to look at that crowd some 2,000 years ago. We could look into our own lives and recall times when we've sinned against our Lord. And there's Jesus at the right hand of God saying, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Forgive them. Let's look to God in prayer. Father, help us to somehow this morning grasp the love, the compassion, the grace, the mercy, the forgiveness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us, O God, to allow this truth of who he is to be translated into our own lives, our own relationships, in our dealings with others. Help us to learn, O God, this tremendous ministry of forgiveness. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In order for us to come to a clear understanding of the word of our text, I want us to first consider the events that preceded what Jesus said. Perhaps you recall, as you've studied Scripture, immediately following Christ's arrest in the garden, he was taken to the hall of the high priest in the palace. And it was there that Jesus was mocked by the men that crowded about him. He was taunted. He was mocked. It went further. He was even struck by them, beaten by them. He was cursed by them. In addition, he was reviled by them. Can you imagine humanity, the created, scorning and scolding the Creator? Can you imagine that? He suffered being reviled by them. But the Son of God patiently submitted and uttered no rebuke for what they were doing. Then Jesus was placed before the council of the high priest. And here men bore false witness against him. Here he was condemned as worthy of death by his own people. Men spat upon him and struck him with rods. Could anything be more disrespectful to the Son of God, the promised Messiah who came to his own and his own received him not? Yet Jesus Christ made no murmur or complaint. And then Jesus was brought before Herod and Pilate. Here he was mocked with a royal robe and a crown of thorns was placed upon his head. The Son of God still patiently submitted to their taunts. Following this, Jesus was hurried away amidst jeers and curses to a hill called Mount Calvary. Our Lord was flung to the ground upon a rough wooden cross. Nails were driven through his hands and feet. And then the cross was raised from the ground and placed in an upright position. Can you imagine the pain as the cross was dropped into the hole that was prepared for it as the nails tore the flesh and the sinew? But even in that awful agony, the Son of God uttered no cry. Below the cross, the soldiers, unconcerned about Jesus' dilemma as they gambled for his clothes. The Jews who stood by about the cross hurled jeers at Jesus Christ, their Messiah. They taunted him with words that had more truth in them than they had ever dreamed. He saved others. Himself he cannot save. He saved others, but he cannot save himself. My friends, it was from this background of events that Jesus spoke. And it amazes me what he said. Imagine yourself in the same predicament, having done nothing wrong, and yet being put to death by the Jews, his family, and by the Roman Empire. Were Jesus' words of condemnation? Were they words of reproof against those who had seen his deeds of mercy and love to the multitudes? Were they words of bitter disappointment because men had given hatred and death for his words of love and of life. No, they were none of these. Jesus simply prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How can we understand these words in such a predicament as we find in Scripture? How can we fathom the love of God as expressed from the cross? I want us to analyze Jesus' words and let them speak to us today. Note again the prayer he offered. Jesus, as the songwriter said, might have called legions of angels to his side and delivered him from the cross, from his enemies, and those that held him in bondage. He might have called down fire and brimstone to destroy those people about the cross, as with Sodom and Gomorrah. He had that power. He had that authority. He might have spoken the word and had the earth open and swallow them, as in the days of Korah's rebellion in the Old Testament. He had that authority. He might have. But instead, your Savior and mine prayed, Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. Think about it. Our Lord, so treated, was praying for them to enjoy forgiveness. Through the centuries, he was praying for you and me to enjoy forgiveness, because our sin placed him there too. He was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world, because in God's foreknowledge, he knew that all would sin and come short of the glory of God. So Jesus was praying forgiveness for humanity. Although none of us deserve it, he prayed for forgiveness. There are many things that we can do about our sins today. As a pastor, I've thought about the many things I've seen people try to do in regard to the sins of their life. They try to separate themselves from them. They try to seek to counterbalance them by good works. They can say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. They can weep over the wages of sin and what they're suffering because of their sin. They can live in regret for the sins they've committed. But my friends, none of us here can forgive our sin. None of us here can forgive our sin. Only God can do that. In Luke 5:21, he says, who can forgive sins but God alone? It's only God that can forgive our sins. We must come to him. We must humble ourselves before him. We must submit to him to know forgiveness. On what basis did Jesus pray? How could God forgive such sin and wickedness? How could he and still be a God of holiness? The implication is clear, and so many times we miss it as we read this passage. Jesus was praying, Father, forgive them and condemn me. Forgive all the sins of the world, O Father, but condemn me. For this cause I came into this world, that I might die for the sins of humanity. Think about it. Jesus, who did not know sin, was here on the cross becoming a sin offering for all of our sin. Our sins were upon him. And when he cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In that moment, he knew what it meant to be a sinner, as the sins of the world were imputed unto him, and he was separated from God the Father. Notice the plea that Jesus made. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." Was Jesus excusing their actions? Of course not. He never has, and He never will. God does not wink at sin in your life or mine. Sin put Jesus on the cross, the just one, dying for all of us who are unjust. So on what basis then was Christ making this plea? He was making it on the basis that they did not know what they had done. In other words, they did not know the enormity of their crime. Men have never known. Think about Adam and Eve in the beginning. How could they possibly know that partaking of the forbidden fruit would mean that Abel would be slain by Cain? How could they possibly know that they would be driven from the presence of God and no longer have the beauty of the garden that God had prepared for them? How could they possibly know that their sins would be visited on generation after generation till Jesus comes again? All the murder, the hate, the vice, the sinfulness, the immorality. My friend, I'm convinced that people today do not understand the enormity of their sins. Mankind today, young people today, do not know how much their sin costs God. The Lamb of glory having to come to this earth and suffer as He suffered. You don't know, my friend, if you're living in sin, how much your sin is costing you. You have no idea what it's doing to you physically, emotionally, and mentally. You have no idea how sin, when it's finished, bringeth death. You have no comprehension that sin is leaving you in bondage as a servant and how hard it is to break the bonds. And tragic beyond tragedy is the fact that men and women do not know how much it costs those that love them. I remember my twin sister Phyllis saying to me, "Wayne, the greatest regret I have is what it's cost my children. I see my sin raising its ugly head again and again in the life of my children." It costs the church. Every sin that believers commit costs the body of Christ. Any lie, any gossip, any fault-finding, backbiting, it costs the church. It costs the church's influence and its outreach into the community. One day, every one of us will know how much sin costs when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But I want you to notice, in this prayer, "Father, forgive them," the precedent that Jesus was setting. Here we see Jesus Christ setting the precedent of all time. He was illustrating by His death all that He proclaimed in His earthly ministry. From the cross, we can see that Jesus loved people instead of retaliating. Our human nature is to get even, to cause someone to hurt or suffer. But our wonderful Savior loved instead of retaliating. And you and I must do the same as his followers. Matthew 5:44a, I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. He prayed for them rather than condemning them. And the Bible says we must too. 5:44 of Matthew says we are to pray for our enemies. Pray for them. That's the action that God asks us to take. He hoped rather than despairing. If these men should be prayed for, we should never give up hope and stop praying for anyone. No one in this community is too wicked. No one in this community is too downtrodden, too evil, too beset by sin that we're to give up hope. There's hope for everyone. And we're to pray for them. And then finally, he forgave because he loved them. Aren't you glad he did? And in Matthew 6:12, it says, forgive us our debts as we forgive others their debts. Wow. You mean I'm going to be forgiven as I practice forgiveness of others? It's what the Bible says. How many times, Brother Absher, do I have to forgive the reviler, the persecutor, the hater, the backbiter, the criticizer? How many times? In Matthew 18:21-22, he said 70 times 7. Using the numbers he used, the disciples knew he meant without limit. Without limit. Mark 11:26 states, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you your trespasses. My friends, we're to forgive in the same manner that Jesus forgave, because he loved people. He didn't want to see them die, be lost. He loved people. We shall never be able to reproduce in heart and life any recognizable likeness of our Lord as long as we cherish resentment, hatred, revenge, bitterness toward each other. To be his disciples, we must love as Jesus loved. I think that's what makes coming to church so good. It's because we come to a community of people who love each other and pray for each other, uphold each other, help each other, and demonstrate the compassion of Jesus Christ. In closing, Jesus prayed, he pleaded, and he set a precedent for forgiveness for your life and mine. I want to ask you a personal question. Do you know forgiveness of your sins this morning? Is all your sin under the blood of Jesus Christ? Do you know the enormity of your sin? What it costs God, what it costs you, your families, your children, your friends, your neighbors, the church? Will you determined this morning to follow the precedent that Jesus set for his enemies? Will you forgive others as Christ has forgiven you? I'm going to ask Brother Wayne, and if he will come forward, And we're going to stand together and have some verses of invitation. If you'd like to come and pray for yourself or for others, the altar on this side is for those who just want to come and pray. Don't want anyone, don't need anyone coming to you. But if you want someone to meet you and pray with you, you come over here. Shall we stand? Brother Wayne, what are we singing?
How great is our God. How great is our God.
How great is our God. Can't argue with that. What an example He has left us to follow. Will you come if God, if you have a need in your life?
Ah!